Tonight, exposure goes undercover in Britain's far right.
And we will find the nearest lamppost and every single one of them.
Yes!
We penetrate the inner circle of the woman who nearly took control of UKIP, Britain's largest party in Europe.
With 21.3% of the vote share was Anne-Marie Waters.
The idea that it won't, that these fuckers can just come along and take it up. Stop all Muslim immigration now.
We're recruited into a new pan-European white nationalist group.
We want to find young, normal people.
Yeah.
I want to get involved, and we train them.
We have fit guys, fit girls, who read or intelligent, for example, degenerates or
And we're invited to secret meetings with one of their European leaders.
You have the Pakis, you have those, you have the indigenous Brits, and you become a minority in your own country. It's the biggest crime ever, you know.
As levels of hate crime increase in the wake of Brexit and multiple terror attacks, we infiltrate a private meeting organised by a neo-Nazi.
They want shooting them fuckers, shooting dead.
Where support is declared for far-right terrorists by people who believe their time has come.
Brexit was about rights for whites.
They've been emboldened by Brexit. And for too long, the authorities have defined the far-right as kind of skinhead, tattooed, traditional Nazis. These people are far more dangerous.
May 22nd, 2017. A suicide bomber blows himself up at a concert in Manchester. 22 are killed. In the aftermath, tens of thousands of people watch videos and share tweets posted by Britain's far right.
Politicians have sold us out. They're working hand in hand with radical extremists.
A war is being waged against the West and our leaders are complicit.
Our political class has demoted the most basic role of government to protect the lives of its people and replaced it with a different role, tolerance of terrorist attacks.
The far right is back, louder than ever. But this isn't the old far right of Nick Griffin and the BNP.
The threat doesn't really come from them at the ballot box. We've got the kind of widening of the far right, so the rise of right-wing populism on a kind of anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim agenda, with the rise of social media and the platforms and the ability to speak to much bigger groups of people.
It seems the new far right has an unexpected profile. Its supporters are younger, with women getting involved from the grassroots right to the very top.
It is a deeply anti-feminist world. And yet, within these movements, you've got a few very strong women who play a key role.
But who are these activists driving the new far right? How big are the groups they run? And are they dangerous? For exposure, three young women who we're calling Hazel, Mary and Sarah are going to try and find out. They're going undercover, which means they'll have to play a long game, slowly building up fake profiles online. Hazel starts first, carefully copying the images and language of the far right in every tweet and Facebook post.
More lies from the mainstream media.
Hazel uses a real photo, slightly disguised, so there can be no suspicion she isn't a real person. Mary starts next.
Who can argue with these figures? Migration has literally skyrocketed.
She uses bold, sometimes shocking language about immigration, terror attacks and media bias to fit in and slowly catch the attention of key people within the far right. Finally, Sarah begins building her online profile.
If I had a printer, I'd print the Brexit letter and frame it on my wall.
All three women spend months online, posting messages and keeping an eye for the real powers behind a range of far-right groups. Soon enough, they find one. The surprise? She started in the Labour Party. She is anti-Islam activist Anne-Marie Waters.
The only evil we have legalised is Islam.
We are sick and tired of importing people who hate us.
She set up a short-lived British branch of the German anti-Islam group Pegida in the UK with former EDL leader and far-right agitator Tommy Robinson, real name Stephen Lennon.
She's now, I would say, certainly in the top two or three most prominent anti-Muslim activists in the UK now. What marks her out as dangerous is that she believes that she is fighting a war.
In the weeks after the Manchester attacks, Waters' Twitter following jumps to 40,000. And hundreds more continue to follow her each week. Soon after, Waters makes a bold announcement. She's going to run for the leadership of UKIP.
For the voice against Islamization to be heard, I will stand in the UKIP leadership election.
Hazel travels to a rally in Manchester, where Anne-Marie Waters is due to speak. She soon hears offensive chants. From the middle of the crowd, Hazel watches as Waters takes the stage. As this video clip shows, Waters' message seems to whip up the crowd.
Islam is a killing.
Yes,
they,
yes.
They want to kill us, they want to subjugate us, they want to enslave us. No, believe me, they're going to try and stop me.
Three weeks later, Hazel heads to Rotherham, where Waters is launching her manifesto. Soon after, UKIP start what they call a rigorous vetting process. Until this is complete, Waters' place on the official ballot is not confirmed.
We are bringing masses of people into Europe. It's not a tiny minority of extremists at all, and I want the truth.
Hazel joins Waters and her inner circle in the pub afterwards. She discovers that Waters is not only a close associate of Tommy Robinson, but also former BNP activist Jack Buckby. Seen here with former BNP leader Nick Griffin.
Syrian refugees, application form.
Absolutely everything
to do with
race.
Taken a Syrian refugee, I hope you don't get raped.
He stood in MP Joe Cox's seat after her murder, despite all the mainstream parties standing back, and has posted inflammatory tweets, including this one, which he has deleted.
Horrible thing to think, but only terror attacks can save Netherlands now. Wake up.
Two weeks later, Waters is on the campaign trail. Hazel goes to hear her speak in Sunderland, where she meets Jack Buckby.
Hey. Nice to see you.
How are you doing?
Hazel has seen Waters happy to work with others on the far right. But Waters and Buckby seem keen not to publicise his exact role during her bid for the UKIP leadership.
I'm basically the campaign manager, but I don't make it too public because she's already getting shit because she's friends with me.
1 month later, UKIP completes its vetting process. They clear Anne-Marie Waters to stand as leader. Though some senior members seem unhappy, other heavyweight figures, including then UKIP deputy leader Peter Whittle, insist she should be allowed to stand.
the whole thing was done very rigorously. There was a vetting process. We all have to go through it. And if you all get through that, then you absolutely have the right to start.
Meanwhile, another reporter, Mary, is focused on a different group. It's called Britain First.
There's been a retreat on some of the issues that progressive people should have filled in on. These people filled it. People retreat to Facebook with their panics and their fears, and they come off Facebook with Britain First messages. And you do see on demonstrations, seemingly very, very decent, as I'm sure they are, decent people expressing their fears on the streets, going on Britain First marches.
In the months after the deadly Manchester bombing, Britain First's Facebook followers increased to an astonishing 1.7 million. Mary sees the group advertise a rally in Rochdale. In the crowd of nearly 200, there are young people only recently drawn to politics, like these two young women.
This is Mary, first time. She's come up on her own.
Everyone's lovely. Everyone just starts speaking and you just feel very comfortable.
Talk quickly turns to immigrants. And their belief that a civil war with Muslims is about to take place.
See, all I can say about it is when we're at civil war, we're taking too far away, when it all kicks off, I'm not going to be one to not say, oh, I didn't do nothing.
Yeah, they got a plan, okay.
The march begins with more highly offensive chanting. Cordoned off by hundreds of police, the speeches start.
These monsters are taking our kids as their sensei's, like their bloody book says. And that is the enemy of our nation. Britain First is no average political party. Britain First is a declaration of war.
The next speaker calls for the death penalty to be brought back for child sex offences, and in a speech focusing on what he calls Muslim paedophile gangs, he says,
when Britain First is strong enough, we will personally take action against every single last paedophile in this country. All of them, we'll drag them out of prison, we'll drag them out of their homes, and we will find the nearest lamppost, and every single one of them will be hanging.
As the march comes to an end, chants are directed at members of the public. Anyone who looks like they might be Muslim. For Mary, the level of hatred is a shock.
It just reminded me of lynch mobs. I was really surprised to see just how many women were there. A lot of young women. There was certainly a big female presence.
After the rally, online, Mary comes across a closed group on Facebook, the Britain First Activists Call. She applies to join. After 3 days, she's let in. Mary is one of a very select group invited to take part in a protest against the building of a so-called mega mosque. She's even collected personally by senior activists from the train station.
How are you doing?
All right.
To maintain her cover, Mary must hand out Britain First leaflets.
Can I give you a leaflet? Leaflet? Oh, you got one already. I'll give you one. It's about the Mayor's Satan Mosque.
Fascist bastards, a lot of them. Scum. Worm.
us, right. Anybody, want to okay. fuck off out of here. Fucking racist okay. cunts.
After getting this vocal opposition, Mary is surprised at just how many people show their support.
Who are you?
The Britain First. It's an organisation that's got their...
I've been looking at joining.
What the idiots in this country don't realise, in 20 years' time, there's going to be a Muslim Prime Minister. I'm not a racist.
No.
I'm not a racist at all. I just don't want him in my country.
They hand out over 1,500 leaflets in under 2 hours. The group move to the local mosque and unfurl their banner. Passing cars sound their horns in support.
I found that there were far more supporters than I expected. A lot of people would come up to me and say, I agree with everything that Britain First stands for. Some said that they're going to join. Strong feelings from a lot of ordinary people just doing their normal day shopping on a Saturday.
We asked Britain First for a response to our evidence, but received no reply.
We can't condemn everyone who, you know, has got concerns around Islamist extremism as an extremist. Here lies in the threat of the far right now. They're tapping into popular concerns, widespread concerns.
It seems the political landscape in Britain is changing. As detailed polling data gathered by the charity Hope Not Hate after the Brexit vote and the most recent terror attacks suggests.
British society is quite resilient to hate. The numbers of people in the social liberal groups has expanded massively, from 22% in 2011 to 39% now. Then on the other side, you've got kind of 25% of society who are both bitterly opposed to multiculturalism and immigration, but even more so now. And particularly when you look at the issues of Muslims and Islam, that 25% grows to 35-40%. The gulf is getting much, much wider.
It is within this aggressively polarised world that Mary, Hazel and Sarah are by now embedded. Mary spots another key individual. Former BNP parliamentary candidate, Julie Lake.
It's vital we survive, we recruit, so we can be here in 25 years' time to protect our children.
And I know she's involved in the hard right, the National Front. She went into the BNP. She was prepared to organise. She's mixing with some of the most extreme and hardline and hardcore neo-Nazi activists, not just in Britain, but also in Europe.
Mary starts commenting on Julie Lake's post on Twitter and Facebook, trying to catch her attention. It works. There's a National Front march in Grantham, and Lake invites Mary to join her.
Make your way to Grantham railway station. We'll collect you.
But Lake doesn't turn up. To maintain her cover, Mary must still go on the march. She mingles with a crowd made up of young and older men, as well as a handful of women.
Grantham hasn't yet suffered from the hordes of the third world. And it's when the third world invades this town, that is when the people of Grantham will start suffering. We'll never surrender, long live the National Front.
Some anti-fascist protesters are arrested in scuffles with National Front activists. The activists boast about this in the car as they give Mary a lift back to the station.
I want that negress.
He had books and a baton in his hand.
Did he?
Hmm?
Yeah, he did, yeah. She looked like actually a big, strong woman, that negress.
Mary has been accepted by the National Front, but she will have to wait to meet Julie Lake. The National Front told us they are not right or left-wing, but patriots, and are confident their members and supporters in Grantham have acted in an exemplary manner. Meanwhile, another of our undercover reporters, Hazel, has received an interesting invitation from an activist apparently close to Anne-Marie Waters. His name is Jordan Diamond from Liverpool. As this video shows, he's attended Waters' events across the country, and he appears to socialise with her regularly. A member of UKIP, Jordan Diamond is also part of a little-known European far-right group. It's called Generation Identity. It uses slick videos to spread its messages via the internet and social media.
Waves of illegal immigration are flooding Europe. The people who've been living here for thousands of years will be an endangered minority in their own countries.
This is Martin Sellner, the Austrian leader of Generation Identity. The group is attempting to bring together a pan-European youth movement to protect the identity and culture of white Europeans from what they call the Great Replacement by immigration and Islamization. They say they're non-violent and have rejected accusations they are nationalists, racist, anti-Semitic or neo-Nazi.
They say that they aren't racist or they aren't far right, but they are defending their vision of Europe is a white Europe. It might no longer be British race or German race, but in a way it's far more pure in its white supremacy. It's quite a kind of a middle-class movement, so there's a lot of people who are students or ex-students who, you know, wouldn't necessarily be comfortable in some of the more street-based traditional far-right.
Generation Identity has over 60,000 followers on social media. As their footage shows, they organise what looks like military-style training for members and chartered a ship in the Mediterranean to try and disrupt the flow of refugees and stop them being rescued by NGOs.
This would never have happened in the past. Not only that they were so brazen in what they were trying to do, but they raised money online and they kind of raised over 200,000 euros. Their ability to both spread their message but kind of fund their operations has never been as high as it is now.
Hazel now has a unique opportunity to infiltrate the group. Via Jordan, the activist who appears to be a close friend of Anne-Marie Waters, she messages him. He tells her she has to go through a strict vetting process.
I sent you details to one of the GIs on the continent. He may want a video chat with you.
Coming up, Hazel makes contact with Generation Identity.
We want to find young, normal people.
Yeah.
Want to get involved and we train them.
And is with Waters in the run-up to the UKIP leadership election.
Kids born in Britain now, and never happened. And you cannot dismiss that as meaningless without being as thick as shit.
Hazel, one of a team of three reporters, has been accepted into the inner circle of the woman who could become leader of UKIP, Britain's largest party in Europe. Sponsored by an apparently close associate of Anne-Marie Waters, Hazel is about to be recruited by European far-right group Generation Identity. She's waiting for a video call from a Norwegian man called Tore, one of the group's senior figures, to vet her.
Hi, how are you?
Yeah, cool. Yeah, we always want to have a chat with people before we bring them to our meetings.
Yeah.
I think that UKIP and other groups that are very rational, they maybe want to stop the immigration, but we think that if you stop immigration to England, that's good, but you still have a problem with the birth rates and what we call the Great Replacement.
Yeah.
So could you tell me a little bit about yourself? I mean, how old are you? What do you do?
Yeah, so I'm 27 and I'm a carer.
We want to find young, normal people.
Yeah.
We want to get involved and we train them.
After the 30-minute video call, it seems Hazel has passed this first test. Hazel is given access to the secret GI Facebook group. She's told to meet at a pub in North London, but she has to be incredibly careful. other activists post messages warning all new members are being subject to what they call extreme vetting.
Too many secret journalist investigations exposed them.
Everybody was vetted to be in this group.
At the pub, Hazel is greeted by a group of young men. Anyone watching would think they were just a group of students.
Like the only white guy in my room, basically. So for young people, your only options are to go out every weekend, get fucked up, take drugs, listen to the house music, degenerate music, watch degenerate videos, you have fit guys, fit girls, read, you're intelligent, like they can choose what team they want to play for, you can play for the degenerates or like the patriots.
Some of these young activists boast about attending Generation Identity camps in France for military-style training.
And there was a good ratio of boys to girls as well. It was really, really good. So we trained for 2 hours in the morning. Yeah. At the end of the week, that was really good. And we did like a mock demonstration, really realistic. And it had like pepper spray, hadn't
it? Oh my God!
It was really organized.
The activists say they had to reject one new recruit because he'd put neo-Nazi posts on Facebook.
I just think when we have a bigger movement, we can be a bit more relaxed about slightly questionable people.
They know they will attract people with neo-Nazi views, but don't want them to damage the group's reputation in these early stages. For Generation Identity, it seems that image is very important. It's just a week until the results of the UKIP leadership election are announced. Anne-Marie Waters is the bookie's favourite. Hazel is invited to join her for drinks after a rally in London. They're joined by Liverpudlian Jordan Diamond, Hazel's Generation Identity contact. Sitting within earshot of Waters, Jordan is asked about Generation Identity.
They're not quite nationalists, are they?
They do have a basis on ethnicity. We don't want to be replaced. It's sad that parts of places like Europe, you know, and even London here, are just being swarmed by the third world.
Would you be happy, honestly, if white people didn't exist? Because naturally, at the rate it's going, we're not going to. No one's going to look like you in 1,000 years from now.
Waters, who could in just 7 days become leader of one of the UK's mainstream political parties, tells Hazel the EU is conspiring to transform Europe into an Islamic state.
We are becoming an Islamic state. The EU agreed to turn Europe into an Arabian Islamic continent in return for trade, essentially. My thinking is we need to reduce their birth rate.
You cannot discuss the idea that most kids are called Muhammad, most kids born in, boys born in Britain now, are named Muhammad. And you cannot dismiss that as meaningless without being as thick as shit and sorry. Stupid is dangerous.
The pub owners told us they had no connection with the group we filmed there. A week later, and UKIP's annual conference begins in Torquay. Hazel is asked to give Waters a lift to the conference. In public, Waters has made extreme statements. But in the car, in private, she's even more blunt.
I can't bear the idea of girls being treated like shit.
Yeah.
The way they are in Muslim countries. Mm. I can't bear the idea of British girls being treated like that in a few generations' time. I can't bear it.
Yeah.
And the other one is Britain itself. I love the country and I can't. The idea that it won't, that these fuckers can just come along and take it off. Stop all Muslim immigration now.
She also says she would be happy to let Tommy Robinson join the party if she wins, despite his notorious past.
Regardless, he can't stand for election because of his record. But I'd certainly open up the party for him to join.
Yeah.
And if he makes his way up the party, there'll be no objections from me.
The next day in Torquay, with Waters still being tipped to win, they're joined by her campaign manager, former BNP activist Jack Buckby. Because of his previous membership of the BNP, he can't officially attend the conference.
I know she's really loyal, but I don't want to screw her at the same time. Because I've got baggage, you know, because of the BNP thing.
Yeah.
Although Amory doesn't, she doesn't seem to think it really matters.
Waters tries to avoid many of the official events, but journalists keep tracking her down outside the conference centre. Her tone is very different to the car journey with Hazel the day before.
You've described Islam as an evil religion. Do you stand by that?
I think there are aspects of it, such as child marriage, stoning to death, which are evil. And if I have every right to say so, this is a free country.
But do you think overall it is an evil religion?
Well, anything that includes things like that, yes. But if you're not going to back to that.
Out of earshot of the surrounding press pack, Waters is less nuanced. Waters goes into the conference centre to hear the results. Hazel waits at her hotel.
In second place, with 2,755 votes, 21.3% of the vote share, was Anne-Marie Waters.
Waters comes second, ahead of five other candidates. Henry Bolton, a relative unknown, beat her with only 8% more of the vote.
What do you say to people that say your views are too extreme for this country?
Well, they're not used to hearing truth. It's as simple as that. The truth sounds extreme when the truth has been pushed out.
Jack Buckby comes to collect Hazel, and they race to the conference centre to collect Waters.
Islam won.
We've been fucking robbed.
Can someone make me? Everyone knows it's a fucking fixture.
In the bar, they are joined by Generation Identity activist Jordan Diamond.
I'm just sick of the people losing. I'm sick of them. I'm pissed off with Geert Wilders didn't win. I'm pissed off with Le Pen didn't win.
If you start a new party and get Le Pen and Wilders over, the council elections early next year.
While most would consider ISIS a death cult, Hazel sees Waters tarring the entire religion of Islam with this label.
But my big answer to finish the answer to your question, yeah. Hazel, my big disappointment is that jihad wins again. Mm. And truth about it is silenced. It's a grand battle against the fascist death cult. We have been beaten again.
UKIP told us it allowed Waters to stand based on a belief that its membership had a right to decide whether UKIP should become a single-issue anti-Islam party. Thankfully, it comprehensively rejected that approach. Ms. Waters is no longer a member of the party, having discovered that her extreme views have no place in UKIP. Nearly 70,000 race and religious hate crimes were reported between 2016 and 2017, an increase of nearly 28%. The success of Waters, as well as increasing support for different groups across the far right, is a serious concern, according to experts, particularly with their use of the internet and social media.
Their ability to intervene in community conflicts, to intervene in this issues around grooming, issues around terrorism, to kind of demonise a whole community is going to kind of whip up tensions in communities where tensions exist already.
We've underestimated social media. It has effectively put a turbocharge on extremists, far-right extremism, far-left extremism, and also the extremism associated with various faiths. And it's something we need to be aware of and we need to be alarmed about.
Coming up, Hazel comes face to face with Generation Identity's Austrian leader.
You have the Pakis, you have those, you have the indigenous Brits, and you become a minority in your own country.
And fears she's about to be unmasked. Our reporters, Mary, Sarah, and Hazel, are still undercover. Mary is on the trail of far-right activist Julie Lake. After months of talking online and missing her at the National Front rally, Lake says Mary can come to a meeting at a secret location in Preston. Sarah, too, has been monitoring what will be a large gathering organised by a neo-Nazi. She's discovered some of those due to attend have links to National Action, the first far-right group to be banned under terrorism legislation.
They promote homophobia, they promote violence and terrorism, and they have no place in this country.
It was unprecedented for the Home Secretary to make a far-right organisation proscribed in law. Also, it's an acknowledgement of the size and scale of the far-right problem in this country. And there's a lot more we're going to need to do about it to contain it and curtail it.
A neo-Nazi youth group set up in 2013. National Action celebrated the murder of MP Joe Cox and recruited scores of 20-something men and women.
Over, you know, 3 or 4 years, it becomes very, very clear that there's a schism in this organisation, that there are people who no longer want to do the dressing up game, who no longer want to just do the secretive meetings and the martial arts. There are people in this organisation who want to be the terrorists.
Since the ban, alleged members of the organisation, including serving military personnel, have recently been arrested, and some now face trial on terrorism charges, including two in relation to an alleged plot to murder an MP. It's the day of the meeting. Mary and Sarah are on their way to Preston. It's not until they're at the station that the organiser calls to give details of the event location. Sarah is first to arrive. She meets Mark Collett, a former BNP youth leader who has a regular online talk show with American white supremacists. He's just been in Europe.
I've died and gone to heaven. Like, no degenerates, everyone's white, and any lefties that turn up get their heads kicked in. I thought, this is perfect. Like, I might, if I could speak Latvian, I'd move to Latvia.
Mary arrives soon after. And then finally, after nearly a year, she is face to face with Julie Lake, who tells her to prepare to be shocked.
Some things you hear, you won't agree with,
right?
You think really quite awful, but that's the thing with nationalism, it has this range.
Inside the meeting room, Julie Lake says she has been corresponding with a member of National Action from his prison cell.
So just to put your mind at rest, he is being treated well, he just needs lots and lots of support.
The meeting organiser speaks next and says Holocaust deniers are heroes.
These are the heroes of the Europe of the future.
He attended a National Action demonstration before the group was banned and says they are not terrorists.
These young men in National Action are labelled as terrorists simply for speaking out in defence of their racial heritage, for their activities to be described as terrorist makes a mockery of the English language.
Julie Lake gets up to speak, the most senior woman in this extreme far-right movement.
But as the first female speaker at these meetings, I just have to say, come on, ladies, get your fingers out, please.
She starts with a warning that interracial breeding will cause the extinction of the white race, and says groups across the far right must unite to achieve real power.
We can't sit around anymore. We've got to get behind established parties, and as Arjab said, is cooperate with each other.
Other speakers say recent events have given them hope.
Brexit was, in fact, the ultimate expression of the will of our fellow Britons to enforce what was just 20 years ago, 20-odd years ago, a very famous BNP slogan, arguably the most famous and effective of all nationalist slogans. Rights for whites. Brexit was about rights for whites.
They've been emboldened by Trump's victory in America. They've been emboldened by Brexit. They've been emboldened by the kind of rise of the right in Germany in particular. And because of social media, they can take part in each other's conflicts in a way, in each other's political battles in a way that they kind of never did before.
After the event, Sarah is given a lift back to the station. She's shocked to hear these activists praise Hitler.
Who is the enemy? Like, who is the biggest enemy?
The Jews. Well, we know Hitler was, right? But the point being that...
if you listen to the radio, you hear my camp. We've got audio.
The first book's much better than the second.
Mary, meanwhile, is getting a lift with Julie Lake. Lake's been friendly, but travelling in the car with her and two men from the meeting, Mary gets a stark reminder that violence is never far away.
I've already been attacked by the anti-fash once at the Southwest Forum.
Been attacked by them before.
Yeah, right. They want to all guillotine every one of
them.
They
want shooting them, fuckers, shooting dead.
Julie Lake told us she has never heard threats or plots to harm others. She says she has no associations with National Action and knows two members only through previous work with the BNP. The meeting was pan-nationalist, and she did not know who was attending. She had never met the two occupants of the car and does not agree with what they said. She said her purpose in nationalism is not hate of one race, colour or religion. Mark Collett told us he takes no responsibility for other speakers at the event, and his comments were made in jest. He says he has no association with National Action and has repeatedly made clear that he does not support or condone terrorist activity. 3 days later, Julie Lake tweeted this about us.
Got someone to check out their office today. It's just a unit in some shithole opposite a used car lot and a plumbing depot.
Hazel, meanwhile, is still undercover with the woman who nearly became leader of UKIP, Anne-Marie Waters. Waters is due to speak at a conference run by the Traditional Britain Group. They've called for the voluntary repatriation of immigrants, including Doreen Lawrence. At the secret venue in central London, Hazel sees Waters and Generation Identity's Martin Selner, who's also speaking. Inside, she meets Waters' associates, Jordan Diamond and Jack Buckby. The crowd of over 120 includes many young people. And once again, neo-Nazi Mark Collett.
I recognise him.
Jordan talks about attacks on Muslims, suggesting they are inevitable.
No one wants since 7/7. What has been done to protect us?
Nothing.
More violence.
In her speech, Anne-Marie Waters says Western white culture is superior and is being destroyed by Islam and its alliance with the left.
The left wants the white majority, let's be frank, to be completely powerless. And multiculturalism tells us very, very clearly that our culture is no better than anyone else's. That cultures which rape, marry little girls to old men to be raped for the rest of her life is no worse than ours. Yes, it is. It is far, far worse than ours. And ours is far, far better.
Martin Selner is up next. Like Waters, he suggests action must be taken to preserve indigenous Europeans against the destructive threat of Islam and immigration.
This problem is called the Great Replacement. It's a combination of our low birth rates and of massive immigration, and it will lead to a complete replacement of our population within a few decades.
The Traditional Britain Group say they are not far-right or anti-Semitic and oppose all political crime and terrorism. The next day, Hazel is invited to join Selna, Jordan and a very select group of activists from across Europe at a training session.
Hi. Hello.
Selna says they are not racist, despite their entire message being the fight for white Europeans against Islam and non-white immigration.
If you nail racism down to understanding, we clearly can say, of course, no, we are racist. We just want to preserve our own ethnic culture.
Selna says they have contact with American white supremacists and anti-Semites, but suggests they don't do this publicly as it would damage GI's brand. He says Jews were a problem in the 1920s, but now the real opponent is Islam.
I completely understand that in the 1920s people said there's a Jewish question compared to an Islamic immigration today. The American alt-right and the American right is again dominated by this anti-Semitism, by the Jewish question. Complete misunderstanding of the time, complete strategical and theoretical failure, in my opinion.
The next day, the group staged their first action. Just after sunrise, they drape a huge banner across Westminster Bridge and upload another provocative video on social media to spread their message. Hazel has to stay away. The activists might be stopped by police and she can't risk being unmasked. She joins them later. For the first time, she senses they're suspicious. The atmosphere is edgy. But Martin Selner is pleased with the morning's activities.
For them, it's like a declaration of war. That we went there, that we put this men in.
Selner continues with his warnings of the extermination of white Europeans.
If you have the British people, and if all these people growing, you have the Pakis, you have those, you have the indigenous Brits, and you become a minority in your own country, it's the biggest crime ever, you know?
Selner says he was an anti-Semite in his youth. Other activists discuss the groups he was involved with after lunch and make offensive comments about the Holocaust.
Yeah, they rejected the Holocaust and stuff.
This has been sensationalised, but it did happen.
Yeah. Yeah, there's nothing anti-Semitic about that. Like, just saying, well, it's exaggerated.
Then the atmosphere changes. Selner has announced that someone else in the group is an undercover reporter.
I would just write a tweet about her and making fun of her, that we exposed her.
Hazel feels she is now being watched. She leaves quickly and does not go back. Generation Identity claimed this programme is a hit piece, with remarks and speeches taken out of context. They say they don't have a hidden agenda, want to preserve European ethnocultural identity, and would not work with American groups. Jordan Diamond told us he is not a racist. No indigenous population should become a minority in its own land, and he does not condone violence. The man in the pub told us he had only received self-defence training in France. Anne-Marie Waters told us she opposes racism, anti-Semitism, misogyny and oppression, usually associated with the far right. She has clearly and consistently said she does not blame all Muslims, but is criticising the Quran, and it is her fundamental right to do so. What others say at events is not her responsibility, and she does not agree with every view at events she speaks at. She did not try to conceal her involvement with Jack Buckby, and Jordan Diamond is not a close associate, but a supporter, and won't be welcome at future events. She says much of what we recorded on covert camera, she has said in public. She doesn't believe the UKIP election was a fix. Jack Buckby told us he explained to our reporter how dangerous neo-Nazis are, and he left the BNP partly because of anti-Semitic abuse. He has never condoned violent activity or terrorism and deleted his tweet because it was not clear. He says he abhors the far right and is not a racist. He does not condone the views of Jordan Diamond and has nothing to do with Mark Collett. He says he talks about Islam but does not demonise the Muslim community. Buckby and Waters associate Tommy Robinson has previously doorstepped a journalist at their home at night and posted the video online. After receiving our findings, Jack Buckby and Robinson posted this disturbing exchange about our reporter, Hazel.
I'm going to try watch this bitch.
Yeah, we need to find her.
I'm going to try...
After their time undercover comes to an end, all of our reporters receive abuse online. They've seen, after 12 months inside Britain's far right, a confident and ambitious movement with the potential to gather more wide-ranging support than ever before.
For too long, the authorities have defined the far right as kind of skinhead, tattooed, you know, traditional Nazis. These people are far more dangerous. Police and government need to have a greater understanding of the impact of social media and the far right's interaction on social media. They reach far bigger numbers and wind up far bigger numbers than they've ever been able to reach before.
What's different now is that you have social media platforms providing a much easier vehicle for extremism to expand, to grow, to flourish. In the same way that youngsters can be radicalised in Islamic extremist narratives, for youngsters to be radicalised in far-right narratives as well, it's the same phenomena. The tragic murder of Joe Cox last year was a point in time. It was a wake-up call as to what can happen if you allow these narratives to flourish and to grow.
If civil society doesn't pull its weight, if we don't take up the slack, if we don't challenge them on the things that they're doing very well on, these small groups of you know, lunatics, you know, won't just be a big noise that they are on the internet.